Welcome to Art Happens. We're here live on Facebook with you today.
All day. This is the last one. It's been all day.
Have
you been watching?
Have you been watching? Have you been watching this all day?
We want to know if you've been watching.
Well, today we're here with City of Play. We're quite excited to talk with our friends about what is City of Play.
What is it?
What is the City of Play? And how can that benefit Pittsburgh? Back with you in just a moment.
Welcome back to Art Happens, and we're very excited. This is probably the last segment, and what better way to end it by talking about play?
Play!
So we're here with these wonderful guys of City of Play. Can you introduce yourselves? Tell us who you are, and what is City of Play?
Go for it, you.
my name is Adam Nelson. I am the founder and director of City of Play. City of Play is a creative nonprofit that designs interactive experiences and real-world games primarily for adults.
Oh, my name's Greg Manley, and I'm the program manager for City of Play. So I'm out there facilitating a lot of the events and interacting with the public as much as possible.
So what happens when you interact with the public as much as possible?
Well, we do a bunch of different things. One of the things that we're doing are kind of large-scale spectacles. We'll have a big ball out in Shenley Plaza. We're out there every Tuesday in the afternoon.
How big is the ball?
It's like 9 feet across. People might have seen it last year at Petanque Tonk or things like that. We bring that out. That's a lot for
9 feet across.
Yeah, it's a giant beach ball. It weighs a lot more than it looks like.
How long does it take to blow that up?
It takes about half an hour to blow up But we also do other things besides the ball. Last year we made a giant playable myth called The Fantastic Adventure. We'll design new games that are like somewhere between immersive theater and pervasive games and scavenger hunts and big adventures that we'll lead the public on a couple times a year. And we're looking forward to doing more of those kind of things this year.
I want to go.
You should.
Yeah.
When's the next one?
Well, our whole season is kind of yet to be scheduled right now because we kind of kick off most of our big events in the spring. But we're starting out with some training classes called Ludovia right now, which is a play. It's a training class that combines skills from dance, martial arts, theater, team sports, all of these things to help adults like find a playful mentality again, put it into practice, and get to know each other more. That starts next Tuesday.
Wait, I kind of
want to
do that.
Yeah, we missed the deadline again.
No. We just started registration for it, so we got open classes. They'll be every Tuesday evening from 7 to 9 p.m. at the Hideout, which is Studio AM space in the East End.
Yeah.
And we'll be offering it every Tuesday evening until mid-May. Classes are open to anybody, all ages, all abilities, and we're looking forward to kind of reinvestigating what is a fitness class when it's focusing on interpersonal skills and the fitness of interacting with people in a playful way, using a bunch of different disciplines.
Yeah, I'm not fit.
No, but you don't have to be fit, but you have to be a good communicator.
Yeah. Right?
That's the basis of fitness that we're talking about.
Got it. And so what do you think, okay, so this is interesting to me. So what do we think is the ultimate kind of goal, right? You created this organization, so why?
I'll give you a short story of how I came to create City of Play, and it changed quite a bit since I created it nearly 10 years ago at this point.
Wow.
But I had been working as a teacher at a summer camp, and in coming back from that experience, I realized it had been a long time since I'd gone to play myself, because a lot of my job there was to go and play with the students between classes, right? To go throw a frisbee or, you know, organize something. And I realized I was about 20 at the time, and I realized that it had been about 5 years since I had myself gone to play without any reason to go play, right? Without a league to be part of, without a sport to participate in. So when I came back to Pittsburgh, I started the organization to facilitate that kind of experience. I wasn't interested in, you know, being in a competitive league. I wasn't interested in playing the same game every time. I wanted to try a bunch of different things. So that was where the original idea came from. Back in, I think that was 2009, when I first started it. It was called Obscure Games at that point, and it was primarily focused on playing new, either games that I made up, games that other people made up, games that I found from historical records, games that nobody quite knew the rules of. We played a different game every week, and the first game I ever organized was actually Greg's game of Circle Rules Football, which he can tell you a lot more about.
So I invented a team sport in 2006 called Circle Rules Football. That sport has since grown around the world.
Circle Rules Football,
that's right. That's the name of the sport.
Well, we are in Western Pennsylvania, so football.
Oh, yeah, okay, fine, yeah. It's actually football more like soccer than it is like American football.
Got it.
And the game has grown since around the world. We had our first World Cup last year in Amsterdam.
Oh, my God.
And it's being played in a couple hundred different schools around the U.S., or at least in North America. Every branch of the military has played it by now. And we're starting a league in City of Play is starting a league for Circle Rules this summer.
So it's like world domination through City of Play.
Yes, it starts with City of Play, and then it becomes County of Play, and then it becomes Dominion. You know, then it's like intergalactic Dominion of Play. Yeah. We're imperialists.
Like, but that's
we're
the
not
idea,
interested
right?
in play
the
at
is,
all.
The idea is to really like, support people with that kind of thing. You know, like that's the if people. We deal with this a lot, which is like, what does it mean to play, you know, and why should you do it as a grown-up? Because that's a child's thing, like it's a child's pastime. But it's so enriching and so fulfilling to play, and that was the like what I felt when I first started the organization. Like, I'm missing this part of my life, and there really aren't many opportunities for me to have that anymore.
Right.
And, you know, Greg, in his creation of Circle Rules Football, he was working on this kind of idea about the intersection of theater and games and you grew up playing sports and doing theater and looking at that as an intersection. I came from an economics background, so I have always looked at this as what is so interesting and compelling to me about economics. Why do we even have an economy in the first place? It's because we like making these interesting choices, and games and playing are these opportunities to make these kind of interesting choices all the time. Well, not limited to that, but yeah, certainly, like thinking about something as thinking about something playfully, like Greg was talking about, this playful mentality, can make really serious things feel a lot more interesting, a lot more fun, and a lot more enjoyable, like a lot more like true living, sort of.
Yeah, but when people see you being playful,
right,
don't they sometimes think you're not serious or being intellectual, and they misinterpret your playfulness as not being
fully
engaged?
Yeah, that happens all the time. And a lot of what we try to do is to change that attitude. And a lot of that is demonstrating how often we play without really realizing it, and how many different forms that playing can take. Do you want to say, we could play a game right now, actually.
Yes,
We shall observe.
No, we got to all play. We're all playing. It's super simple. It's basically as simple as rock, paper, scissors.
Okay.
It's called Touch Your Face. No. Have you played Touch Your Face with us?
No.
All right, all you got to do is touch your face. We're all going to touch our own faces on the count of three. Here's the trick. If anybody touches their face in the same place as anybody else, they're out. So it's the last person to touch a different part of their face wins. Clear?
So you can't, just do it on three. You can't keep touching
Ready?
The same place.
One, two, three. Touch your face. We're all three out. You're right. You got your name. No. So you just won. Right, play again. One more time. Ready? One, two, three. Touch your face.
Okay, everybody's in.
Everybody's
in.
We're almost mirroring.
I think that's okay.
You're still. One, two, three. Touch your face. We're out.
All right, so you and I play one more time.
Yeah.
One, two, three. Touch your face. All right, one, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. All right, anyway, it's good enough.
All right.
I can't take it.
I like that game.
That was a stupid game that I came up with in 30 seconds, and we just keep playing it again and again.
I have to tell you, that is so funny. And the other thing that blew my mind was my son, who is nothing like me. He's very tall and blonde. He's only 14 years old. He's 5'11". He's blonde. Big person. Was selected to play in the Ultimate Frisbee, you know, travel team. So next thing you know, I'm putting him on an airplane. He's going to Minnesota. He's playing in the national championships.
Wow.
It's outrageous. And he's never played this game in his life, so I had to go to this tournament. You know, I had to drive him.
He's never played the game in his life?
He's never played the game, but he's just somehow
But he was
really
chosen
good.
To go on a
he's
traveling
very
team.
Good at this, right? So he tried
he
out for the
born
team.
To play.
And, well, there were a lot of kids that tried. I
mean, well, he could just reach up and grab
he
it, right?
Grab the thing, right? Because in the age group.
Oh, okay. So he has played Frisbee before.
Right.
Okay.
I have no idea.
I couldn't.
I got so bogged down. So the first day of the tournament, I got so bogged down in trying to figure out the rules so that I felt that I could watch the game and understand what was happening, that I felt, finally I realized, you know what I really want to do is just go get a hot dog over the concession stand and go watch my kid play this game and have fun and stop this incessant chatter that this thing that's supposed to be fun and enjoyable has to become some other language for me in order for me to fully enjoy it. And I was sort of robbing myself, so I can really understand what you're saying about laughing and having fun and enjoying each other and relating.
Well, you're getting into some deep stuff right now. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say you're talking about rules. So when you guys are creating a game, you have to do the behind the scenes rule making?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how do you test it out?
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Well, you can go about making rules from a familiar set of rules that people have by just adapting something that people typically play, but you're putting it in a new context. Mm-hmm. So that will be easier for, it'll be a shallower learning curve if you're just adapting an existing game.
Right, like what's a foul,
Yeah, exactly, you'll learn, you'll know those kind of things because you've played a very similar game before.
We actually do exercises. We run workshops occasionally, and one of our exercises in those workshops is to start out with a simple game of catch and then to start adding rules to that to modify it. So it takes a very basic game that everybody kind of intuitively understands and starts to add more and more of these rules on top of it to transform it into something that's totally new or totally unrecognizable.
Hmm. Wow.
But then there's a whole other aspect of how you make somebody feel comfortable at a new game.
Does anybody ever freak out?
Yeah, sometimes.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, if you hit them
well,
with something that's like more intense.
We forget how to play, so we get
all
like
something that's suddenly more
it.
Intense or makes them feel more vulnerable than they've been used to in a while. You know, we try to like, We say that the playing begins at consent and ends at celebration, which means as soon as you agree to come and play a game, we're responsible to your experience. All the way through the beginning of the game until the game is over, and now we have cause to celebrate or commemorate
high five,
it. Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. But our responsibility as hosts starts as soon as we say, do you want to play? And you say, yeah. And even if you don't know what you're playing, at that point, I need to start taking care of you and saying, well, what kind of things have you played before? Like, how, you know, like, I'll find out what makes you laugh, come up with a way to like have a person-to-person interaction, and then bring you into a new experience. And then, you know, if we do a good job or if the process is long enough, we can make that experience more and more complicated or more fantastic, or we can bring you further and further out of your comfort zone, but the entire time we're taking care of you from where you start when you say, yes, I want to play.
And speaking of taking care, so you take care of lots of communities. So you take care of the community that you probably live in, and then there's the community of people that hire you.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So how do you do that? Because I imagine, is it the same, do you take care of them in the same way, or is it different in a sense?
Ooh, well, that's a hard question to answer, because there's no, one of the things that we don't do is a lot of prescriptivist stuff. Most of the time, people that we work with are asking us to do something that is reactive to something that they're putting out. So if we're working with a community, for example, the community might come to us and say, we have this issue, or we have this event, or we have this experience that, you know, we want to get this idea across. How can you help us? And that every single time is a different scenario. So there's no format for us specifically in how we do a process like that. It's also similar to how we work with whenever we're occasionally hired to do interactive experiences, experiential design, that sort of thing. And that can range from doing an immersive experience to designing a custom board game to a variety of other things. But every time the problem is very different. The approach to designing or working with another group, though, is similar, which is that we're all human beings, we all have human needs, and we all are looking for certain assurances or certain frameworks that can help us feel more comfortable.
Yeah, can I take a turn answering that question?
Yeah, yeah.
So the question was, how do you communicate professionally as opposed to personally, or how do you take care of your personal home
community as opposed
to your
professional community?
You're talking
about like taking care of people,
community?
So I imagine taking care of clients is very different than taking care of maybe like kids
or your people
or your neighborhood.
So I'm relatively new at working in a kind of business to business level. My background is in performance. I was an actor and a dancer and a puppeteer and a kind of mask performer, and I did event production. So for the most part, my client interaction has always been interacting with the public,
yeah.
Right? And in that way, I want to make people feel taken care of, or I want to make sure that people understand what I'm trying to communicate. Mm-hmm. And that blends very much into how I look after my own home and my own, you know, personal connections as well. So I think when I'm feeling like I'm doing the best professional work, I'm communicating as deeply and intimately with a client as I would be with a family member or a loved one.
There's a method to that, though, and this is something that we've developed over the course of the last year in training volunteers to do some work with us or to otherwise, you know, help us create these interactive experiences. The topic is collaboration, right? Mm-hmm. One of the really interesting things about games and playing is that, unlike basically all other media, games are interactive. And a game doesn't exist without the players who are contributing to it. So when we invite you to play a game, we enter into an agreement that we're going to collaborate to create something that is really interesting and exciting and profound and beautiful and not always pleasant, right? Sometimes
right.
very challenging, sometimes difficult, sometimes stressful.
Or competitive.
Or competitive, or aggressive, or whatever. But the prospect of asking you to join us and asking you to be our partner, right, in becoming a player, is one that is a combination of confidence and humility, which in our point of view, that those two things together are sincerity. So we don't.
And that's art right there.
Thank you.
Yeah. Right, definitely, yeah.
Well, the reason that it's really important to get these ideas across is because games are so often seen as insincere, or they're so often seen as frivolous, or
yeah. a folly.
Yes, exactly right. The experience of one person connecting with another, though, is not at all a folly. It's not at all. I mean, that's kind of the most profound thing that we can do
right.
together. And the reason we treat our games and anything, even the silly touch your face game, right, is said like, we are confident you're going to like this. We also will respect and be humble to the idea that maybe you won't.
Right.
And so very sincerely.
I liked it.
Right?
Yeah, it was really fun.
Well, but very sincerely we can say like, this is a fun game, and if you are commit to like joining us, then we are going to have a good time together. And that like that sincere belief is what we try to convey in terms of working with anybody that we work with, whether that's a stranger on the street.
Who are some of the people that you work with? Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, we did like, we worked with, I think, 40 or 50 different clients last year in a variety of capacities. And then those can range from community organizations to international companies. So we've built board games for large-scale, we built board games for large-scale clients that do procurement services across the world.
Mm-hmm.
We built the world's largest functional game of operation for Allegheny Health Network. You may have seen it touring around.
That's awesome.
And then, right, yeah, exactly right.
I love that game.
But then on a much smaller scale, we've also done, I mean, we also show up at museums and like engage the community there. We did a lot of work in Fineview last year. We did a lot of work on the north side, which we're in right now.
Woo!
Right? Yeah.
The street.
Greg did, worked pretty heavily with the north side block party. And
right.
That's right, I was there every time.
I went
with
to the
big
one
ball.
In Manchester.
Did you? Okay,
with
yeah.
the big
film. I was there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, we work with a broad spectrum of people and clients and organizations to do all manner of things that are all centered on the central idea of like, it is better when people have a chance to interact with each other and have a new experience together.
I could see you guys doing a lot with like the juvenile detention system and well, other kinds of things like that.
Well,
sure.
It could happen. I mean, I think right now, you know, our capacity is pretty limited, so we have to make sure that when projects like that come, we're ready to take them on.
Yes.
But that's an exciting prospect. And we're these Ludovia classes that we're teaching
Can
right
you spell
now.
That?
Ludovia is Ludovia, which just is derived from the Latin meaning playful way or playful path. So it's a practice, it's a physical practice that helps people interact with each other.
I love it. And Ludovia.
Yeah, it rattles
because we,
off
I mean,
the tongue.
Let's, we start to forget as we get older. We get like, we have a certain way. We
you mean about physical interaction?
Yeah.
Well, just like engagement, you know, people start nailing down their narratives of their life and that's how they interact.
That's
and
right.
They get kind of locked
Routine.
In.
Yeah, and
all
identity.
That stuff, so
well,
play
another thing
kind of
is,
breaks you through, breaks.
That's
Don't get me started. So identity has become something that you rely on, right? For your reputation, for your friends, for how people see you in the world.
Certainly
but
if you
become tied to your identity, then you cease to be able to explore
There's
and
no
reinvent
creativity.
Yourself.
Yeah.
Right? So playing gives people this temporary space where they are allowed to relinquish their identity and just be a human.
Yeah.
With another human again, right? And this is what is at. This can give birth to great imagination.
Sure. It's
because
like
you
an
can surprise space. Yourself.
Yeah.
Right? And that's something that as we get older, we get out of the practice of finding those places where we allow ourselves to surprise ourselves. And that's really growth, you know? That's where real joy can come from.
This is why I like cooking.
Yeah? Tell me more about that.
Yeah, I love cooking because it's creative. I can sit there. It's one of the only times in my life where I'm alone. I have two teenage boys. Mm. And I get to create and experiment and think through things and bump up against other ideas, try stuff out.
Yeah, and at the same time, you're playing with cultures of food, right? And your spices are all like,
hold
all these cultures in them and different mixes. And so you're like, oh, maybe we'll get a little Cajun today. You know, maybe we'll go to India
Cajun.
Today. Whatever, you know?
India,
Well, so cooking is really is a neat example, right? Because every step of cooking, you have an opportunity to make meaningful choices. So like starting from what am I going to cook, that's a meaningful choice, and you get to make it, right? To what am I going to cook with these ingredients? You know, okay, well, I have chicken, and I have you know, soup base, and okay, well, what can I do with that, right? And that kind of invention, right, is very stimulating. It's very much like that is the thing that makes... makes people excited and about doing any kind of work, right? Because your cooking is work. It requires energy, requires effort, but for you it feels like playing.
Right.
Because it is so fulfilling intrinsically. I do a lot of thinking about the intersection of work and play.
Clear.
And they're really the same thing. The best work is play, and play is, you know, the child's form of work. It's also So play is the child's form of work, and work is the adult's form of play. When it is, you know, really done right and fulfilling.
That's so cool.
Right?
Yes. And tell us.
Right?
Yes. So tell us. Please tell our beautiful listeners, how can they find out about Ludovia, City of Play, what it is that you guys are up to, so that they can know how to interact with you.
Sign up for
Well, you can first
games.
Go to cityofplay.org.
That's exactly right.
That's the easiest place to find every bit of information about what we're up to. You can also find us on Facebook, City of Play. Look us up. And
Twitter, Instagram. We're also on both those, at City of Play.
Yeah.
Very, very,
And if
very
people want to contribute to your organization to keep this good work
Thank you for
going.
Mentioning that.
Where should they go to make
We
that?
Have a Patreon account. So for those of you, do you guys...
Patreon is something I
Patreon
love.
Is, Patreon is a way of like giving a monthly donation, like a monthly subscription to Pandora or something like that for $4 a month.
Yep.
Instead of that, you make a monthly donation to an artist or an arts collective.
Oh,
and
like that,
it's a way for them to fund big and riskier ideas because, you know, on a small scale, everybody who's watching them, just give them a little bit. So you can give $2, $5, you can give as little as you'd like, but just enough to help us keep doing what we love to do and sharing
without,
it with
Without
our,
you having to stop what you're doing to write all these grants.
Yeah, it's
you
just a way to
just
have easy, quick,
happening.
like, interaction between our patrons and us.
Well, and our patrons also get, you know, we try to send them little gifts. So Greg makes invitations for them. We send them little games occasionally.
And you get discounts on Ludovia, and you get discounts on all of our public offerings.
I love it.
So it's a way to be like involved with us and supportive of our community. Actually, though, the best way to find out more about City of Play is to come to one of the things that we
do. That's what I want to do.
We do stuff all the time. We organize events more regularly in the summer months. You can find all those things on our calendar page on our website.
Perfect.
But upcoming, we host a weekly board game night at Hambone's Pub, which is
awesome.
Free, open to the public, super fun.
It's every
Everybody's
Wednesday.
Super, super friendly, 7 o'clock. We also do dodgeball at the Ace Hotel once a month. That's on Monday nights. Actually, the next one is coming up next week. So I believe it's the 13th, we're going to be at Ace running dodgeball. You don't have to have a team. It doesn't. We use soft foam balls. What's the phrase? We're more average Joes than Globo Gym. So if you want to come down and just have fun and throw some balls at each other, that's another thing that we take. We do a lot. Ludovia, obviously, is coming up soon. And
there'll be more on the calendar.
Yeah.
So go to cityofplay.org. We want to thank you guys so
thank
much.
Thank you so much for
coming
in
today.
To us.
Thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure.
Thanks for joining us on Art Happens.